garages everywhere. Mechanics meet, Farkles are wrenched, rides are planned, stories are told, and dreams are hatched. This is our garage. Welcome to Farkle Garage. I'm Kim Rock. Over here, the man of many motorcycles, Clive Ironbutt Brown, a man with even more motorcycles, Hall of Famer Steve Drain, and the gal who can't pass the safety cone without riding around it, motorcycle instructor Dar Duncan. And over my shoulder, our own Farkle Garage band. Today's show's a dirty one. Clive wrenches with Cyclops, Dar says WTF, F is for Farkle, and the gang rolls around in the mud. But first, Clive meets a family brought closer together by two wheels and dirt. All this and more on this episode of Farkle Garage. Asking your parents for a motorcycle when you were a kid? For most of us, the answer was no. Well, this island kid's parents actually encouraged him to ride. In fact, motorcycles have brought this family closer together.
You have fear at the start line, but then once the gate drops, your mind is on other things. Get to the front. It gets pretty rough in the back. Bike to bike, bar to bar.
They practice starts again and again.
It's definitely the most adrenaline pumping part.
The drag race to the first turn.
Hold it wide open, all the way out to the corner. Don't look sideways. Hold it on longer than the person right next to you.
After the corner, risk replaces fear.
If one thing goes wrong, then your race is over.
Motocross is an endurance sport. 15-year-old Wyatt practices twice a week, 30 hours of saddle time a season.
He's at the gym three times and rows every day.
Then there's school.
He's very proud of his marks.
His days are full.
He's tired when he gets home. No time for video games.
And yet...
can't stop everything. Just being around everyone at the races, riding. There's nothing else like it.
Dad gave him his first bike at age 4.
He had 11 85s.
Racing started at 7. He's done well. He's got the trophies to prove it.
Over 80.
But his greatest reward doesn't fit on a shelf.
It's definitely not like other sports.
Racing's brought this family closer together.
That's the biggest thing about motocross.
And for this Western Canadian champion, it means lots of racing.
Any given weekend, there's 2 to 3 races.
In 5 years, Wyatt's traveled over 120,000 kilometers with mom and dad.
When you're camping 28 weekends a year, it brings you pretty close.
My dad once said, it was our job to open the doors, their job to close them.
Weekends can mean 6 different starts. Races last roughly 15 minutes.
After that, they're back in the campsite, hanging out with their dads. When he was on 50s, sometimes I didn't sleep. We're rebuilding clutches and changing tires and just getting ready.
Today, Wyatt's the mechanic.
I don't really let my dad touch him anymore.
But racing's not for everyone. It's expensive, both in time and dollars. Harold says he's had to make sacrifices.
Changed my job. I sold businesses just so I could spend time with him.
I don't know, they just do everything for me.
Because sooner or later, they're 19, 20, whole different interests in life, not the old guy sitting in the corner in the rocking chair.
And racing's dangerous.
It can be. I broke my right humerus, my radius, and my left humerus, and my collarbone, and my femur.
Mum had asked him to stop.
But she lets me do it.
His parents understand his tenacity.
Do it for yourself, and if you quit tomorrow, I'm okay with it.
They're proud to say they've watched him go from tricycles to this.
80 kilometers an hour and hitting a 120-foot gap. What's not to be proud of, really? You know, like, he's a good kid. As far as 15-year-old kids go, I couldn't ask for any better. He absolutely loves this sport. We do it for him, he doesn't do it for us.
For the Ulans, the motorcycle has become a common bond. Like the sport of motocross, it's a family affair.
It's probably the only sport around that 20-year-olds hang out with their dads.
And with the family's support and encouragement.
My dad says, have fun, get a good start, and be safe.
And a very cool dad.
The coolest.
His race career's just getting started. For young Wyatt, you could say, the sky's the limit.
What a great story. Thanks, Clive.
Welcome. It was amazing to see what the motorcycling had done, pull this family together. And yes, kids, motorcycling can be dangerous, because if you get involved with motocross, next thing you know, you'll be wanting to go camping with your parents on the weekend.
Well, I think those parents must be so proud, because I know when I was 15, the last thing I want to do was hang around with my folks. It's amazing how much time those guys spend together.
And they look forward to it.
Hockey moms and hockey parents. Yeah. I mean, the support's there, not taking that away from Canada's pastime, but, you know, like the amount of driving that they do.
And the life lessons that the young guys got out of it. I mean, it couldn't be a more competitive, individualistic sport. It's a race.
Yeah.
And having said that, the team camaraderie that's built in the pit area, if his competitor that could take him out in the next race needs a part, they'll run over there and give him a part. And the practical things that he's learned too, like, you know, the mechanical aspect of it.
After the break, Clive does a Farkle install with Cyclops. Not a Cyclops, Greg from Seattle's Performance Lighting Experts, Cyclops Adventure Sports, and the Garage Gang plays in the dirt at West Shore Motocross. We'll be right back.
It gets black out there. Riding alone on a dirt bike in a 24-hour race, the motorcycle's headlight is shining straight ahead, not where you want to go, not where you're looking.
So, Daryl Van Nieuwenhuis built the first Cyclops light, a product that lit a path to a career. Joining us in the garage, Greg Vammen, Daryl's chief lighting tech. Greg, welcome to Farkle Garage.
Thanks for having me, Clive.
Tell me, where did Cyclops come from?
Cyclops came from a desire to ride at night after work. Daryl quickly realized the Enduro headlight was not sufficient to be able to have light where he looks. And he used his background as a toolmaker to fashion the first Cyclops helmet light. From that helmet light, we've spawned all these other different products that we have now to show you today.
How would the average guy on the street tell the difference between a really high quality LED light and one of lesser quality?
Cree is definitely the leader in LED light emitting diodes.
That's the little yellow piece that you see in the bulb.
Right.
This has got one LED, that's
one,
correct?
One 10-watt LED.
A little yellow thing in there.
Yeah, but okay. but look at the reflector.
Right.
So you've got four LEDs in there, but you look at the different size of the reflectors. It's going to be a light that is going to allow you to be seen more than actually see. It's going to allow you to see, but not nearly as much as this, because it's reflector technology. This is a 20-watt light. This is a 10-watt light. This light gives you 850 feet of usable light. This will give you 300, maybe 400 feet of usable light. It's going to allow you to be seen. It's going to allow you to see. Mm-hmm. And you're going to be able to ride with that heated vest.
Oh, yeah. Okay, then, let's go put some of these Farkles on my bike.
Greg installs a light bar, Like all Cyclops lights, the penetrator is housed in heavy-duty, powder-coated aluminum.
It's got 25-degree reflectors on either side to give you a spread of light off to the side, and then four 10-degree spots that give you that penetrating light down the road.
Cooling fins dissipate heat, but should the light overheat, the system will slowly reduce intensity until cool again, then return to normal operation, because heat is the LED's worst enemy.
Is that the case with all LED lights out there?
No, that's the case with our LED lights. That's engineered into our lights when we produce the light.
That's the kind of thing you can't see.
Exactly.
That's built into the engineering of the light.
Exactly.
Next, Greg replaces my stock headlight bulb with a Cyclops fan-cooled, waterproof LED.
So why would you want to change the bulbs anyhow?
Well, Clive, besides lower power consumption, you have a brighter color temperature than your halogen bulb.
Twist. Now we just have to put it back on the
Literally,
light.
Plug and play.
Plug and play. Away you
Gotta
go.
Love that.
Stock lights throw an orange-colored light. This LED is a whiter, brighter light, more like sunlight. How much brighter? Have a look.
Wow, that is bright.
Yes, sir.
Don't look at that, boys and girls.
Cyclops Adventure Sports, lighting technology and innovation, helping riders see and be seen.
With everyone talking dirt, the Farkle Garage Gang decided to visit West Shore Motocross to play in the dirt ourselves.
Most of us started riding on dirt.
It's been a long time. Have been out on a track.
Dust to dust.
Just the love of dirt bike riding, really.
You get the picture.
Oh my God, I love this. You're never too old to play in the dirt.
In dirt biking, it's always the physical side, so you get that endorphins, that adrenaline, you get really pumped on it, right?
This is work.
Realize how much better shape you should be in before you start doing something like this.
I just have to lay down.
Yes, we're old as dirt, but so fun. West Shore Motocross started 6 years ago with six bikes.
And now we have 60.
West Shore provides the bikes, the gear, and even courses. Or you can bring your own. They host parties for all ages, from kids on training wheels to bachelor parties and ladies' nights. Jeff says that for riders, it's more than just playing in the dirt.
Way different than street riding.
It improves your skills on the street.
Really helps if you're out on a rainy day or you come around the corner and a gravel truck's lost a little bit of sand on the pavement and you're like, oh God, what do I do? Dirt bikes, we're just used to that sliding. It's part of how you want to ride.
Jeff says that falls are part of learning to ride off-road.
I want to!
The gears built to protect you.
Did you see that?
You gotta look ahead.
I got caught in a rut. A mud rut.
If you would have looked farther ahead, you would have gassed it a little bit more, which would have pulled the bike straight, and that would have allowed you to get through there without losing your balance and tipping over like you did.
It was crazy. It was fun, though.
Like anything,
it's all seat time when you're dirt bike riding.
Seat time. I know where I'm booking the next Farkle Garage team building event. Right here. After the break, hashtag WTFarkle. Dar brings us something new and innovative to bolt on your bike. We'll be right back.
I can get lost in a paper bag. And while there's lots of navigation tools for cagers, the choice of aftermarket GPSs is limited for bikers. Here's one you can beat your drum about, the new TomTom 400, a satellite navigation system built specifically for bikes.
We let the TomTom 400 take us for a ride. The GPS comes with everything you need. The RAM handlebar mount made for a quick install. The articulating arm makes positioning simple. The built-in battery lasts up to 6 hours. Consult your manual or motorcycle dealer if you're going to hardwire the GPS with the supplied battery cable. I liked how smoothly the unit slips on and off. The rotating mount's a nice touch. The vertical position showing you more road ahead. If you prefer to leave the GPS on the bike, TomTom sells an anti-theft solution. Unlike most GPS units, the TomTom 400 is waterproof, but don't use the supplied USB cable in the rain unless you can make the connections watertight. Use the hardwired cable instead. The TomTom 400 is easily readable in sunlight. In our opinion, better than car units and phones. It's also dimmable at night.
This GPS gets you from A to B like all the others, but it's how it gets you and your bike there that's exciting.
Routes can be planned on the GPS, but we like planning longer routes on the computer. The TomTom 400 uses MyDrive Connect, providing lifetime map updates and a way to upload custom routes. Simply enter your destination. We created a round trip. Next, choose how hilly and how windy you want it. Then upload the route to your TomTom and you're ready to ride. Our favorite route planning app is the MyRoute app, which downloads routes to the TomTom as well as a variety of other GPS units and phone apps. Clive and Paul planned a recent ride to Idaho this way. The real beauty of this GPS is that it transmits audible turn-by-turn directions to your helmet communication system via Bluetooth. It also connects to your phone. There's even real-time traffic updates and safety camera alerts.
Imagine a GPS unit built for bikers. Get one? The choice is yours. After the break, a man who never gets lost around motorcycles, Bev Gorlankin joins us in the garage to share a motorcycle survival story. We'll be right back. Joining us in the garage, a man who's been collecting the classics all his life, together with the stories that ride along with them, Bevan Gore Langton. So Bev, this bike has a tale to tell, a bit of a war story.
Yes, it's a wonderful old motorcycle. It's a 1925 FN, a Fabrique National. It's a Belgian motorcycle. To me, the motorcycle is basically a tribute to what I consider a very brave German fellow. When I purchased it, I went to Todd Copen's show. It was held at Twassen in those days, a wonderful swap meet. And as I walked in, sitting outside were a few bikes for sale, and this stood out to me, and I went right over to the fellow to look at it, and there was a fellow standing by it. So I asked him the history of the bike, and he told me it belonged to his father. Around 1933, the Nazis took power, and they And later on in the 30s, they started expropriating what they wanted, particularly vehicles. His first name was Harry, the father of Huey, that owned the bike. When the Germans came for the bike, he told them that it was stolen. And of course, they didn't believe him. So they said, okay. This was standard, what they would tell you. It was, we'll search your home. We'll search your friend's home, and if we find it, we'll shoot you. But wow. he had the guts. He wasn't going to let them have that motorcycle. But I've talked to three other people that gave up their bikes because of what they were told. You can hardly blame them.
No.
How did he hide it then, Ben?
He had friends around Hamburg. That's where he's from. Mm-hmm. And they had farms. He had some good friends, and he gave one friend a gas tank. Another toolbox. He spread the bike all around the outskirts of Hamburg.
This one right here?
This one here.
Wow.
So it was separated. The bike was in pieces all over the outskirts of Hamburg. And he got away with it after the war. He got it all back except for the header pipe and that collector, which is like a muffler. And and it was just cobbled together. But those parts were missing. So my dear cousin, Kim Napier, built the parts for me.
It's amazing that they got all of this stuff kind of back together, particularly with all the chaos going on at that time.
It's amazing. It all came back except some parts that could be made, which is basically original, even to the blocks, brake pads.
Yeah.
Brake pads. I've been studying those. You know.
Is that really wood?
That's real wood. Probably those are original. Original brakes.
Wow, that's amazing.
Didn't you call them ABS?
ABS,
I think they'll never lock up.
Those will definitely never lock up.
But they are a forerunner of the disc brake, basically.
No. All for the love of a motorbike, hey?
The love of a motorbike. Yeah. He risked his life.
Is that a toolbox on top of the tank?
That's a toolbox. Let's have a look at it.
Oh, it's so beautiful.
Let's open it up. Okay.
Okay.
There it is.
Gosh, my toolbox doesn't look like that in my bike.
Oh, it's got the tools in it.
Let's have a look.
Dude. Mm. Drum roll.
That's a good one, Doug.
What have we got in there, Bev?
Oh, these hands are good. Oh, my gosh, FN. Look at that.
FN tools.
Oh, my gosh.
Look at that.
That's an FN tool.
See, and that is so amazing because, like, this is the stuff that gets lost. It's an FN tool, just like it says. This is the stuff that gets lost.
Oh, absolutely.
The little bits.
My goodness.
That's the stuff that's lost. All right, that'll probably do everything on the bike.
Yeah. My goodness.
It's quite a privilege just to touch the history. Like, we're going back 70 years.
It is, you know. Sometimes I feel vibrations coming from this dying thing.
Yeah.
The levers on the right-hand side, Bev. One is throttle and one is distributor?
One is either choke or maybe advance and retard.
Advance, retard?
I think it's advance, retard.
And the throttle, you would just set the engine speed and away you'd go, eh?
See, the British kept those for years.
Yeah.
So it took them a long time to change.
Have you actually ridden this motorcycle, Bev?
Yeah, oh, sure.
It was twist throttle. You literally just pull the levers.
Wonderful. It's wonderful because you're not having to keep your hand on the throttle.
Oh, yeah, just pull it to wherever you are cruising.
And it stays.
Shifter on the right, down by the tank.
Shifter on the right, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, there it is.
Yeah, clutch up here.
Clutch up there.
Convention, yeah.
Clutch there, standard.
Rear brake on the left side.
And kind of semi-hidden controls, too.
That's amazing for 1925, isn't it?
Yeah, we think about the people that customize, a lot of Harleys nowadays, they go for the hidden controls, right?
Which is very nice.
It's very elegant, like all the
clean lines.
Aren't they beautifully made? Beautifully made, yes.
Yeah. No, it's something to behold, Bevan.
You can just feel the history coming off of it. It's just amazing.
I can. It's a story that really gets me. I love the bike. At the show, just after I bought it, was an awfully nice young boy, about 16 years old. And he was down on his knees, sort of put his hand on the tank.
Yeah.
He said, "That's the most beautiful motorcycle I've ever seen." He said.
Not right.
So obviously he felt it.
It spoke to him.
Yeah.
Well, I'm getting choked up.
Well, I do too. You know, I get very emotional over some of these things.
If this was my bike, it would be in my living room.
Would it?
Absolutely.
Well, I had a rudge in our living room for years.
Oh, did you really?
Joy put up with it, but she couldn't get at the windows to clean the windows.
Who needs to clean the windows? You'd be looking at the bike all the time.
That was nice of you to take it out.
I did take it out. Better than doing the vacuuming myself all the time.
Evan, thank you so much for bringing this motorcycle along.
It was telling us the stories.
I
thoroughly enjoyed it. I really had fun.
We have fantastic. Too.
Good to see you, Steve.
Yeah.
Steve,
it's really, really good.
Thank you.
Tremendous story.
Thanks, Bev. Before we go, let's visit the place where bike stories and collectors come to find each other, the classic and vintage motorcycle swap meet in Surrey.
Steel, chrome, and Farkles from our past. Rooms filled with vintage memories, punctuated by colored stories.
Got lots of guts.
This is a picker's paradise, a custodian's convention.
We're only the caretakers of these bikes.
Because you can never really own a classic motorcycle.
I'm searching for some memories.
I don't even call it my bike.
A lot of hearts.
We own them, we can buy and sell them. But I think we've got a certain duty to maintaining them.
BC's hosted the classic and vintage swap meet for 30 years. A place where parts part ways and collectors collaborate.
It's the social event of the year.
See the bikes and relive their youth.
So you having a good time? Oh, great time.
Having a chat, seeing friends they see once a year.
For some, it's a treasure trove.
I found that bike in this show.
The 1925 FN Bev told us about in the garage.
I was walking in, and I saw this sitting outside, and I, like a magnet, it attracted me.
How are you?
I'm very well, thank you.
For others,
it's the parts.
It mentions Indian there, but it could have been used on any motorcycle.
It's a tactile thing. A lot of the guys that are into this, they want to be able to touch the parts, look at the parts, feel the parts before they buy them. You can't do that online.
Bev finds a light to fit the FN.
It works on carbide, water in the top reservoir and the carbide down below, and you adjust the drip here, and it'll drip and it produces a gas, and then it comes up, and that opens up, and there's the jet for the gas to come out. And they're bright.
They come from across North America. Over 150 vendors lure thousands of caretakers and the curious.
Restoring a 67 BSA Lightning right now.
Clive came looking for parts for his Rudge, like the one his grandfather used to ride. a bike in the early stages of metamorphosis.
It's a 1934 Harding invalid carriage, so it was developed in England after the First World War to help the people coming back from the First World War without the use of their limbs.
We all come for the stories these bikes tell, like Bev's FN, or this rare relic.
It belonged to my wife's great uncle, who used to drive this up and down Hastings Street in Vancouver till about 1940, 1950.
One of just 20 alive today.
They have a life of their own.
I love living with it.
But these bikes cannot talk, except through sign and form. Rather, it is their caretakers who give them voice.
I love that old motorcycle.
Riding it, restoring it. They strip it down, they touch every bit and piece as it goes out to the chrome shop or the plating shop, and it becomes just part of them. It really is an extension of the guy or gal.
In return, the bikes they preserve and protect bring them immortality.
It feels to me like they've got a soul.
Embedded in that soul, the caretakers who cherish them.
You're responsible for it, and you maintain it.
Who eventually pass them on to another, perhaps younger custodian, eager to touch timelessness.
The pleasure they gave people and the experiences they had on them, boy.
And so, the meet becomes a classic people show.
Beautiful.
For without them, these rides are but steel and chrome.
They have a soul, absolutely.
A soul that lives forever in the hearts and minds of those who cherish them. Chrome, steel, and stories. Shared at places like this and in garages everywhere.
Thanks for joining us in the garage. Have you got a story or know someone who does? Send us an email, share it with us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, and we'll share it with the world. We hope you enjoyed hanging out with us at Farkle Garage. Ride safe and remember, a bike on the road is worth two in the shed. Later, big...
Riding gear provided by Climb. Technical riding gear.
Did you guys see him hook up the light?